Open rebellion is too dangerous, Master Coda. I know I owe you my life, but...
You don't owe me anything. I told you on Cloud City that I can't help you. Not since I lost my sight. He's your hero, and it's his rebellion. Join us because he's asking you to.
You are the first to really fight the Empire. We're not prepared to go to war yet. We need weapons and starships and people with the courage to use them. I don't know how many others will stand with us.
But surely you know some who will.
Well, yes, there are other senators who have spoken out against the Emperor. But they will be hard to convince.
We just need to show them that the Empire is vulnerable.
Let me meditate on that. I'm sure we can find the right target. In the meantime, Senator, gather your friends. We're gonna need all the help we can get.
Master, he's here.
You have received my message?
Yes. Your mission goes well.
I have recruited others to my cause, but now I need your counsel. My allies seek a major strike against the Empire.
The Emperor rules the galaxy through fear. We must destroy a symbol of that fear. The Empire is building Star Destroyers above Raxus Prime. That shipyard is your next target.
Thank you, Lord Vader.
There is much conflict in you. Your feelings for your new allies are growing stronger. Do not forget that you still serve me.
I hate being him.
I think he does too.
Master.
Juno.
I came to find out where you wanted to go next. But it looks like you've already been told.
Juno, this isn't what it looks like.
Of course it is. You're still loyal to Vader. After he branded me a traitor and tried to kill you, you're still his
slave.
Then why did you defy Vader to rescue me?
I needed someone to fly the ship.
We both know that's not true. My being here has never been about my piloting. Sometime soon, you will decide the fate of the rebellion, not your master. And when you're faced with that moment, just remember that I too was forced to leave behind everything I've ever known. Please, don't make me leave another life behind.
Aloha, everybody, and welcome to part 9 of Star Wars The Force Unleashed. So, we're back on Raxus Prime, the junkyard planet that we visited back in part 3. And if you've been paying attention to the last 3 levels, we visited Kashyyyk for a second time, we visited Felucia for a second time, and now we're visiting Raxus Prime for a second time. And this is going to be the last time that we visit a previous area. This is going to be the last time. After Raxus Prime, every single level we go to will be completely original, so don't worry.
This is the closest I can get you. Once you find a way to the processing plant, we can use the ore cannon to attack the shipyards directly.
And just like last time, we're going to be running into a whole bunch of Jawas, we're going to be running into a whole bunch of Rodians with miniguns and whatnot. Obviously, they have gotten a lot stronger since the last time we were here. But then again, so have we, so it's kind of the same enemy types we saw back in Part 3. Right off the bat, I just found a power crystal. This is Sigil. Sigil increases the damage of every single one of your electricity attacks. So when you use Force Lightning on people, it'll be stronger if you have Sigil equipped. And if you do the Sith Slash, Sith Saber Smash combos that I love doing oh so much, whenever you have Sigil equipped, those are going to do extra damage, and they're going to drain people's health even better than they already do. So it's not a bad crystal to have. I still kept Rubot in there because I like having extra damage with just basic lightsaber attacks, not just lightning. But if you want Sigil, that's a pretty good lightsaber. It's definitely the best one underneath Rubot's, and the last one I'll be getting in the very final level. And I mentioned this back in Part 8. This is the second last level of the whole entire game. After this is the final level of the game, so you may be wondering if the plot's really going to ramp up in the next part. Oh yeah, the plot definitely forwards and gets to the conclusion in the next part, so the plot's a little uneven. I feel like there should be more build-up to the final level, but as soon as you reach the final level, that's when they drop all the plot and stuff, and yeah. Things are getting tense on the Rogue Shadow. Darth Vader senses conflict in Starkiller. He sees that we're getting a little bit attached to our new friends. We're getting attached to Coda. We're getting attached to Juno. And that's not good. Because Sith should not really have attachments. I know people said in the comments section that, like, oh, well, Clement, Darksiders do have feelings because that's why they turned to the dark side in the first place. Like, that's why Anakin Skywalker killed all those younglings and turned to the dark side because he had an attachment to Padme and he couldn't let go of things and he had feelings, you know? And I guess, but I feel like love is a feeling too, and I feel like you should have love and empathy, and that's like something that Jedis generally have more than the Sith. I don't feel like Sith are people who have so much love in their life. I don't feel like Sith are filled with sympathy, you know? They react, they are very emotional, they're very angry people, they're very reactionary, but I don't know if I would suggest that just because they're emotional that they have sympathy and good feelings towards people, you know? But the point is, like, Starkiller, he's getting all warm and fuzzy, and he's not the cold, distant Sith assassin we started this game off. He's getting real close to Juno Eclipse, that Imperial pilot we got at the beginning of the game, who isn't an evil, racist Imperial. Because, like, some people might assume that, like, if you work for the Empire, you must be automatically evil, right? Like, if you're a Stormtrooper, if you're any one of those Imperial Shuttle guys, oh, you're definitely evil, because you work for the Empire, and everyone in the Empire is evil. Throughout the Expanded Universe, there's tons of characters in the Empire who, they work for the Empire, but they don't really know about all the evil stuff that the Empire does. And they truly believe that Emperor Palpatine just wants to make the galaxy great again, you know? And the Rebel Alliance, they're terrorists. They're disrupting peace in the galaxy. They're attacking stations and disrupting everything. And hey, you just gotta serve the Empire, because the Empire are good people. Good people. It's actually a big part of Juno's backstory that she led this massive attack on this planet. And she actually had conflicting feelings about that because she didn't know if she did the right thing and if what she did was kind of inhumane and horrible. And Vader was so impressed with that battle that she assigned her to the Rogue Shadow to drive Starkiller all over the place. It's in... This is all documented in the data bank of Star Wars The Force Unleashed. Again, when you push pause, you go onto the data bank menu underneath costumes and whatnot. You can learn a whole bunch of biographies about all the characters. Juno Eclipse is not a pure evil, racist, doesn't believe in everything about the Empire. Like, her family brought her into the Empire. She's been loyal to the Empire until they tried to kill her.
Eclipse to Starkiller. We have a small situation here.
Go ahead.
Proxy has left the ship. I have no idea why.
I do. I know what he's doing. Thanks for the advance warning.
Oh, Proxy.
Juno have reached an Imperial drop base. Can you override the hangar door?
I'll try, but it might take me a moment.
Take your time. I've got plenty to keep me busy here.
I said before, I do like the story of Star Wars The Force Unleashed. I like all these cutscenes. I love the motion capture. I love all the actors involved. But I still don't really consider it canon. And one of the few reasons I don't consider it canon is because there's a lot in this game that is hard to swallow if you're at all familiar with the movies. And it all makes Like, everything in this game is exaggerated like crazy. Like, when we fought Kazdan Paradis back in Part 3, he has a whole bunch of junkyard enemies that you have to fight because he's literally manipulating all of that with the Force. And if there were Jedi who were that powerful in the movies, how in the hell did they ever have trouble with the droids? How in the hell did they ever have trouble with the Count Dooku and the Emperor and all that stuff? I mean, maybe I'm crazy, but I just feel like if Kazdan Paradis was not, like, one of the top tier, better than Yoda, ultimate Jedis ever, it's a little bit hard to swallow. And coming back to Proxy, you know, this is a droid that was made for Starkiller, who has a lot of crazy capabilities. When we first are introduced to Proxy, he is in the disguise of Obi-Wan Kenobi, and he fights Starkiller trying to kill him until Starkiller stabs Proxy, and he goes back to normal, and he goes, "Excellent work, Master! That was even better than the last time we fought!" Like, Vader has trained and programmed Proxy to specifically kill Starkiller. Like, he's not... There's no training wheels here. If Starkiller doesn't defend himself well, Proxy will kill Starkiller, and Proxy will feel like he's accomplished his mission because that's his programming. He's supposed to kill Starkiller in a duel. So we got references to that in even, like, the level, the Empirical, when Starkiller asks Proxy, "Did you launch the escape pods?" And he goes, "Oh, yes, Master, I'm driving the ship into a nearby star. I knew you were still trying to kill me." "No, no, Master, not yet." But he is trained to kill Starkiller, and he is equipped with all of this data inside of him that, like, he can project a hologram of whoever, right? If he wants to relay a message from Darth Vader to Starkiller, he can look like Darth Vader, and, you know, no one can tell the difference unless they start touching him and stuff. "Oh my god, that's Darth Vader." You know, if he looks like Obi-Wan Kenobi, you just think, "Oh, it's Obi-Wan Kenobi," because Proxy can turn into that. And apparently, he has combat data of, like, all the Jedi. Like, Starkiller has fought, like, tons of Jedi that Proxy has become while training to become a Sith assassin under Darth Vader's control, you know? And it's like, that's a hard pill for me to swallow, that a droid like that exists, and that the Empire wouldn't have tons of those droids, you know? you figure that, like, if there was a droid that can literally copy Jedi's combat data, that have Force propulsion systems in them so that they kind of have the Force, like, Proxy can use Force techniques on Starkiller because he has Force propulsion techniques, like, Force propulsion systems inside of his robot frame, and it's like, If Proxy can become whatever Jedi he wants, wouldn't that make him one of the best soldiers ever? Cool guys don't look at explosions. Starkiller is one of the most badass Star Wars characters ever. It's ridiculous just how badass he is. And once again, this stormtrooper I couldn't hit with the lightsaber. It was just like in the Felucia level. For some reason I kept slashing him, but nothing was happening. I don't get it. I don't get it. And when Starkiller got onto the airship, he threw that stormtrooper off and he made this sound. That is the Wilhelm scream, and that is a big trademark of Star Wars. Along with the phrase, "I've got a bad feeling about this," you've probably heard the Wilhelm scream in every single piece of Star Wars ever. Like, all the prequels, all the original movies, there's probably been at least one guy who went, "Ah!" And you've probably seen it in a ton of movies and whatnot, too.
"That tractor beam is maintaining the alignment of the cannon. If you can disrupt it, maybe it'll affect the firing pattern of the facility."
Okay, so the bonus objective of Raxus Prime is right with this tower. I have to destroy the 5 side panels with electricity, and once you destroy all 5 panels, the tower will collapse, and that's pretty much it. That's all the bonus objective entails. All we have to do is destroy this tower, and we're done. That John Williams score is so good. I don't know how many people have played a lot of Star Wars games, but, like, generally, mostly every single Star Wars game just recycles all the music from the movies. And so if you've actually played a lot of Star Wars games, these tracks kind of get repetitive because I love the John Williams score, but I can promise you I've heard this song in tons of other Star Wars games. You know, I might have heard it in, let's say, Jedi Power Battles, or Shadows of the Empire, or pod racing, maybe, you know? Like, all of this music just shows up again and again and again, and every now and then you play a Star Wars game that has original music. Like, I know BioWare's Knights of the Old Republic, that's pretty much mostly original music, you know? Like, I think the only thing that's, like, John Williams' score in KOTOR is, like, the opening crawl and the ending crawl. Like, the credits. I think that's the only thing that's John Williams in Knights of the Old Republic from BioWare. Whoa! That elevator does not seem stable if it just drops and my character falls, but whatever. Oh, this part's kind of tricky. You got snipers that are everywhere, but there is a Sith holocron right on top that gives you invincibility, and you should take out everybody that you can as long as you have that invincibility. But when you have snipers everywhere, and there's a big lava bottomless pit underneath that you can fall into and die, you gotta make careful double jumps and careful air dashes in order to get to those snipers, because this place could be pretty damn dangerous, especially if you don't notice the Sith holocron with invincibility. If you don't grab it, you can lose a lot of health in this area, especially in the higher difficulties, but that is a very tricky jump, it is very specific, and there's a holocron over here, and that's the only reason I'm jumping over to this place, so I can get this holocron. It's a lot of lava and death below us. You gotta be very, very careful. Gotta be very, very careful. But Knights of the Old Republic has an original score. Force Unleashed has some original music. Like, Starkiller has a theme song. It's on the title screen. It happens occasionally. I think it's going to be happening in one of the cutscenes at the end of this video, actually. So there is some original music composed for the Force Unleashed. And just most of the time when you play Star Wars games, you always hear the John Williams music. And again, it's great. John Williams is one of the best composers of anything, you know. But if you've played a lot of Star Wars games, the music gets a little bit repetitive, I'm just saying. Just a little bit. But getting back to Proxy, I just think it's interesting that Proxy, he can fight like Jedi, he can impersonate whoever he wants through holograms, so like, he can be Obi-Wan, he can be Darth Vader. You'd think the Empire would like mass-produce that guy and make him like one of the big Empire-like soldiers. Like, how could you imagine an army of Darth Vaders, an army of Obi-Wan Kenobis going up against rebels and stuff? Like, that would be crazy. Now, I'm sure the budget would be high, but it's the Empire! You own the fucking galaxy! You got a space station that can blow up planets! Who gives a shit? Make as many proxies as you can! You know, I look at the original trilogy, I look at the movies with Luke and Han and Leia, and I don't believe a character like Proxy could exist in that world. It just seems, that's why it doesn't seem canon to me, this game, because there's just so much over-the-top, ridiculous stuff that I can't imagine Carrie Fisher in this hallway with these stormtroopers. I can't imagine Harrison Ford palling around with Starkiller. It's a little weird, you know? It's just as weird and conflicting as seeing Episode 1 was for a lot of people, where, you know, Episode 1, it was on Naboo, you had the Gungans, you had Queen Amidala in her weird dress, and then you look at that, and then you go and look at Episode 4 with Han Solo and Obi-Wan and the droids, and you're like, are these even the same universe? I mean, Star Wars can be a lot of things, don't get me wrong. There's tons of different planets, tons of different cultures. Be all that you can be, but Force Unleashed just feels a little too outlandish for Star Wars sometimes. I don't know. You might disagree with me, and by all means, if you think Proxy can fit in this world just fine, then by all means, he fits in this world just fine. But either way, folks, we got ourselves a boss fight. This Shadow Guard. Well, he's not much of a boss fight. We can beat up this guy just like any other.
My onboard tactical computer suggests that this is the best time to attack. I am certain that I will finally fulfill my programming.
Just kidding, that wasn't a Shadow Guard, that was Proxy. The first phase is kind of a boss rush, although it shares one health bar, so it's not really a boss rush. It's just that Proxy will be cycling through Maris Brood, Shock T, General Coda, every single boss you fought up to this point, including the Shadow Guards. And you'll just have to get used to that. Like, every now and then he'll change tactics. Like, sometimes he'll be invisible as Maris Brood. Sometimes he'll be doing Master Coda's techniques. Sometimes he'll be doing Shock T's techniques. But he still has a pretty small health bar, and as long as you just concentrate lots of attacks on Proxy, you should be fine. But this is a two-phase boss fight, and I would actually argue this is the hardest boss fight in Sith Master, Sith Warrior, Sith Lord mode. It's really hard.
Shut down, Proxy! There's no one inside you that I haven't already defeated!
Give me some credit, Master! I have one module you've never seen. An enemy I've studied for years.
Oh my god, he's Darth Maul! Darth Maul, in my opinion, is the hardest boss in the game, simply because the amount of damage he does with his combos is ridiculous. Compared to the final bosses I'll be fighting at the very end of this game, Darth Maul has a combo where... Look at my health! My health was full, and he drained it that much just from one combo. And you can bet your ass that in Sith Lord and Sith Master mode, he does even more damage. So you really gotta make sure that, like, when he starts doing that combo, it just drains your health like nothing. It drains your health like crazy. And he's really good at blocking force repulses sometimes and blocking lightning. And, like, your best bet is to throw items at him because it'll usually catch him off guard. And you gotta block. Like, you absolutely gotta block. And when he starts coming for you, that's when you do the force repulses. Because Darth Maul will kick your ass. Proxy has been hiding this guy for a good reason. He is really, really tough to fight. I'm playing in Sith Warrior mode, so he's not the worst he can be. But I remember I beat the game in Sith Master mode, and this was absolutely the hardest fight in the game for me. It took me forever to beat Darth Maul. Don't worry, we didn't kill Proxy, we just stabbed him with lightsabers and he didn't fall apart somehow. It's like in part one, when they show him as Obi-Wan Kenobi. Starkiller clearly stabbed him through the chest, and you'd think that would, like, really just screw up his circuitry and whatever. But nah, he was fine. Proxy's fine, even though we just broke his double-bladed lightsaber, which he manufactured somehow. I mean, that's the other thing about Proxy. How does he spawn lightsabers and stuff when he just appears like a humanoid droid guy? Proxy's really weird. He's a little too hard of a pill to swallow, because he's just... There's too many questions. As Bruce Wayne in Batman Forever says... There's just too many questions about Proxy I have, and, yeah. The thing about Darth Maul fight, the Proxy fight, that really makes it annoying, is that when you die to Darth Maul, the second phase, you have to go back to the first phase. So you're really fighting two health bars, and if you're getting your ass kicked by Maris Brood, Coda, Shock T, Proxy, then Darth Maul is absolutely going to wreck you because your health doesn't really regenerate. You don't have enemies to fight off during that whole thing. It's not like he spawns in a whole bunch of enemies to get health back from. And that's what kind of makes it hard in the higher difficulties, is that you all have to do it in one health bar, kill both of his health bars, while he has that ridiculous, super strong Darth Maul combo that just drains your health like nothing. So, Darth Maul Proxy's, in my opinion, the hardest boss fight in the whole entire game, especially on the higher difficulties. But either way, folks, In order to finish this level, there's this thing in the middle that's shooting a whole bunch of fireballs up into the sky. I don't know what this is. It seems to be a railgun, I guess. That's what they call it, but there's the fireball getting launched up into the sky. We just have to shock all four of the things on all four of the towers, and then we're good to go. Then we're heading to the final part of Imperial Raxus Prime.
One of the Star Destroyers, it's headed right for me. I gotta get out of here.
You'll never get clear in time. You need to pull it into the cannon.
What? You're insane. It's massive.
You're a Jedi, boy. Size means nothing to you. Reach out with the Force and grab that ship. Reach out with the Force and grab that destroyer.
Don't interrupt yourself, Coda. Okay, so this is one of the most infamous parts of Star Wars The Force Unleashed. Not only because of the story reason that, yes, Starkiller is so strong in the Force, he can literally pull a Star Destroyer, one of the biggest Imperial ships in the galaxy, and bring it down from outer space, bring it down to the planet below. But also from a gameplay standpoint, I remember a lot of people had trouble with this when the game was new, and there was a lot of message board talk about how, oh man, the Star Destroyer segment took me like 11 minutes in order to bring it down. So here's what happens. Right off the bat, you're getting attacked by TIE fighters, and I actually cleared them out pretty quickly. And my only tip is go up to them, push the right trigger button, which is grabbing things with the Force, and just grab them and try and throw them, or just, if you grab them, they'll generally just fall down if you let go. You don't even have to flick it in any direction, but I just run to where the TIE fighters are. I keep mashing the grab button, hoping that I'm going to grab it and bring it out of the sky and smash it. So once all the TIE fighters are destroyed, that's when you have to activate the Force grip again, and you have to actually manipulate the left and right analog sticks and until eventually they turn green, and then they tell you to pull down. And once you pull down, you hold down so that you can bring the Star Destroyer down. Now, every now and then, TIE fighters are going to keep coming back, and they can do a lot of damage to you if they start shooting you, so you'll have to let go of the Star Destroyer to destroy the TIE fighters. And I did this in two cycles. Believe me, a lot of people have trouble with this. I don't really know why. I don't really think it's that complicated or that hard. But you just want to throw away the TIE fighters when they start attacking you. And then just pull a Star Destroyer down. And yeah.
Relax, General. I'm still here.
Good. Good. We'll see you back at the ship.
Master?
Proxy! Are you okay?
Yes, I think so. But I think it may be best if you leave me here.
What are you talking about?
The shockwave, it burned out portions of my processor. My primary programming has been erased. I'm useless now.
Roxy, you're not staying here. Come on.
And that, ladies and gentlemen, is Imperial Raxus Prime. The Star Destroyer segment I'm going to be talking about again in the next part because I want to kind of give my thoughts on it. You guys probably have your own thoughts about it. I'm sure a lot of people were actually surprised I two-cycled that segment, because I know a lot of people have trouble with that, and I honestly never had that much trouble. I managed to get the TIE fighters pretty quickly just by mashing the grab button for facing their direction, and when it came to the analog parts, I just followed the directions until it told me to pull them down, and then when I just held it down, pulling the Star Destroyer to the planet, so I don't know what to tell you, but that's a crazy moment in this game. It was also the big moment of the teaser for Force Unleashed. Like, the big teaser for Force Unleashed before there was any, like, cutscene details or story details or anything was that we just saw a Sith character in a black robe pull down a Star Destroyer, and that was the teaser for the game. And I was like, whoa! Who can pull down an entire Star Destroyer? That's crazy. That's Unleashed. The Force has been unleashed. But, you may think that Part 10 is going to be the final level, but actually, this game has a lot of DLC. And I'm going to be tackling a DLC level before I go to the final level. So in Part 10, we're going to be visiting the Jedi Temple. Till then.